Good morning, everyone. Your Excellency, the Deputy Prime Minister, my dear friend, Mom Rajabong Priyaton Tevakun, the Dean of Wharton School, Mr. Jeffrey Garrett, dear colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. My background is a little bit confusing because I was supposed to be staying in some fields close to finance, because that was my original career with the Central Bank of Thailand. But then I went on to trade and then to something else and politics and a bit sometimes messy. But when I went to Geneva to take the helm of the World Trade Organization, they said, why did you come here? You should be somewhere at the development organization in the UN. You should go to UNCTAD. So I stayed at the WTO for a few years, and then I went from the WTO to UNCTAD. When I went to UNCTAD, they said, why did you come here? Why don't you stay at the WTO? Because we're not, you know, we are not rule-making institution. We don't want you to come here to, you know, the UN development unit to impose something on us. They don't want that. And so I was a bit confused. When I was with the lawyers at the World Trade Organization, they tried to teach me some legal rules, and I tried to teach them some economics. And then it was, can you see how confused it is? And so I had a lot of jokes, bad jokes about lawyers, and I have some bad jokes about economics. I won't tell you today, because just to save time. when I went to the UN, of course, it was just a different kind of thing. At the UN, and I'm saying this because I want to make a reference to someone whom I greatly respect, I can't call him a dear friend, but I was working closely with him for a certain period of time at the UN, and he taught me a few things. This is the late Nobel laureate, Professor Lawrence Klein. I'm saying this because I'm very envious of all my friends who've been to Wharton School and have gone on to great heights like Mom Rajabong Priyaton and some other people. I have not had the great fortune of being educated there, but I have a great fortune, very lucky to have had the experience of meeting with Professor Klein for a few years during my working period in Geneva. Around about 2005 and 6 and 7, when I was starting to work with UNCTAD, I was asked to do some work, because at that time we were beginning to negotiate on the Doha round and trade and development. It was very difficult to convince countries, particularly countries like India, to fully participate in trade liberalization. And so we need to be able to determine how trade could be really harnessed so that it can serve development purpose. And as you know, UNCTAD is a very unconventional think tank. We don't think like other peoples in development. We have our own theory. For example, we don't believe that it's an automatic thing that trade will help, or liberalization of trade would help development. We think there are so many different other constraints and there are other conditions. So I was thinking of Professor Klein because I saw some of his work for which he got his Nobel Prize. And so I invite Professor Klein to come to Geneva and to head an advisory group to help us in devising some econometric calculations so that we can determine, let's say, the association or correlation between development, trade factors, and other factors. And it was this association that I came to appreciate Professor Klein tremendously, because he actually, in the beginning, he came from a different point of view in trade liberalization, but when we ended the project, we came to determine that besides trade liberalization, macroeconomic discipline, infrastructural investment, competitiveness, entrepreneurial capacity, investment in social affairs, in social investment like education, healthcare, all these have great correlation coefficients with development besides trade. And when we relate trade to all these coefficients, we did see that trade alone cannot carry the weight of total development. I'm saying this right from the beginning because trade and Asia seems to be very well meshed in together, that we have actually come up in Asia mainly through the trade route, which is a good thing. And you can see now at the moment, if you go to China, the leaders of China will be talking to you nothing else except on the revival of the Great Silk Road, of the Great Silk Road. And what the Chinese leadership is talking about at the moment is not the Silk Road that would go through Xi'an into Kashgar, into Central Asia. This is what we call the land route of the Silk Road. The Chinese leaders are talking about maritime Silk Road, which is to incorporate all these countries around China. Because when China actually committed to the Silk Road, maritime Silk Road, they went to Korea. And they went down to Southeast Asia, through India, to Venice in Italy at the moment. You can see that the revival of trade along this line, as I'm telling you, is not really to go back to the origin of what actually Asia used to do well, but it will have some of the geopolitical implication, which I will come back later. But let me finish with what Professor Klein has been helping. So he actually helped me establish this kind of thought processes, and we actually elaborate on it furthermore to prepare countries to build capacity. You need to have capacity to trade. Otherwise, you open up your countries, you have openness, but you have nothing to trade, so you won't gain. I invited Professor Klein back for a special occasion, which we call the Raoul Prebisch Lecture. You know Raoul Prebisch. Raoul Prebisch is a former economic professor from Latin America. He was the first Secretary General of UNCTAD. And he was the one who actually came up with the center-periphery theory. He came up with the theory of the trade-off between agriculture, trade, and manufacturing. This is Raoul Prebisch. And so we established a special series lecture, and I invited Professor Klein to come back to give this special lecture, Raoul Prebisch lecture. And at that time, Professor Klein gave this lecture, which is called, I took a copy of this lecture note with me. It's called South and East Asia, Leading the World Economy. This was back in 2005, in November 2005. This is South and East Asia, Leading the World Economy. He was talking about two countries in those days, about how China will manage the process of growing like this for some time into the future, and how India would try to replicate the same situation with China in those days. He told me, and in that lecture, he actually repeated the message. When China opened up in the 70s, in 1978, 79, a group of American economists were invited to come to China, because the Chinese, they invite us to go. A group of us from Southeast Asia, we also went to China towards the end of the 1970s. And a group of American economists were invited to go to China. Professor Klein was leading the delegation from US, and so he went there. He went there and he said, well, we cannot discuss much because we don't know what you are actually, how much you are producing, where you are producing, what is your investment, what is your rate of interest, what is your rate of inflation, and all this sort of thing, because in those days, well, not really statistics have been officially accepted. So he brought along Professor Irving Kravis. This professor, I don't know, but he seems to be a great economist in terms of calculation of national income account, national input. So he brought Professor Kravis along, and the team actually, for the first time, I was told, even also by the Chinese friend, but this team, for the first time, sat down and talked to the Chinese economists and came up with a kind of calculation for the Chinese economy for the first time. So this is, for me, again, a great contribution. And in that calculation in those days, which I think still quite reliable in the 1970s, so in 1970, Professor Kravis and Professor Klein calculate that the per capita output of China in those days was about 12.3% of the US per capita output, 12.3%. Philippines in those days were 13.2%. India was 6.6. well, if you look and compare to the figures these days, it will be quite amazing because China has gone to nearly twice that figure now. It's just beyond 20%, 25%, whereas the Philippines and India has not actually gone up very much. Now, I mentioned all this, I mentioned the figures, I mentioned the revival of the Silk Roads, but before I go towards the kind of remodeling of the Asian growth model of growth policy, let me say a little bit something about all these figures. You have to be always very careful when you come to Asia and compare figures here and there, because I wouldn't say that the figures are not reliable. They are reliable, and particularly those figures, the numbers that come from the Asian Development Bank, reliable. But then the interpretation of the figures and sometimes the way the statistics are being collected in India, in China, and with the new calculation of the so-called the purchasing, purchasing manager index, the PMI, you can have different PMIs and different interpretation. A few days ago, I was shocked because in India, friends told me that Prime Minister Modi just came up with the figures that now we are going to change the way we calculate our statistics, our national income. Well, I'm not so sure that this is the right approach to change the statistics and allow some of the growth statistics of India to come up a little bit. So Premier Modi was saying that this year India will grow by 8%. Most of us would think that this year, if Mr. Modi would carry out all the reforms that he's supposed to be doing in governance, in subsidies, in agriculture, India would come up to something like 6.5% at best. 6%, maybe 6.5%. But to go to 8% like something like 5, 6, 7 years ago, it is a little bit, for us, exaggerated. In China, same thing happens a few years ago. As you know, there has been some miscalculation of the invoicing of the import and export. There has been some exaggeration of the export figures. As you can see, when you go to different provinces in China, in the past, when they had the socialist plan, everybody has to exaggerate the figures a little bit so that they would get more budget. These days, sometime when we try to calculate together with Chinese friends, adding up all the figures from all the provinces to make a national figure, sometime there must be some difficulties in calibrating. So, and there's been again some misreporting of the export import figures. So I think it is quite wise, and this is the present premier of China, Li Keqiang, who actually he came up with his own index. So this is the index that normally I would like to use, and many of our friends, when we talked about things in Asia, we would use the so-called Li Keqiang index, which he said, well, I don't have much trust. This is something that he said years ago when he was the governor of Liaoning province somewhere in China. Li Keqiang was saying that I would trust figures like this. First, I would look at the level of the usage of electricity. How much people are using electricity? Then I know actually whether consumer demand will be there or not. He would look at the rail cargo. Then I would know there will be trade in China, and that I can measure, I can rely on the trade figures on the rail cargoes. And the third one, this is the three components that he used. This is the volume of loans that are made by the banks in China. Now, these are things that you can see that the present premier of China, he has really this kind of economic thinking, which I say would be very much pragmatic to be looking at the moment, why you have to check on different figures. When I was in Europe a few days ago, I just came back from Hamburg, two things happened. In Europe, people were very excited. Why? Because they are doing something that the Americans are just stopping to do. They just phase out. In the US, they phase out quantitative easing number 3. Stop going back to the same old normal monetary policy and not to do any more quantitative easing. Whereas in Europe, after several years looking at the US example, and they should have spent time doing this in the last 3 or 4 years, and then the Greek situation might not have deteriorated so much, but they just decided the other day to do quantitative easing number 1. And so it was a very exciting time in Europe this day. I was talking to a group of businessmen, and they were saying, look, what are you thinking about the currency in Europe? I think, well, yes, well, I don't know whether you like it or not, but I used to be associated with Europe when 1 euro was 0.8 cent, 80 cent dollar. And I was there in Europe when it was 1.5. And we were given the task of looking at how Europe would be able to handle its economy if it goes up to $1.8 for 1 euro. Today, I think the one-to-one is a par now at the moment. 1 euro will buy $1. And in the next couple of years, it will certainly well nigh come down to the level below $1 for sure. But this is something that pleases the European traders very much. And so I'm very much concerned this day with the kind of situation that as you look at the growth of Asia, become so much dependent on the global economy to grow. And when there was a golden period of growth in the global economy between 2000 and 2007, Asia did not stop being more involved with international trade. So the average level of trade share, export share in the Asian GDP went up from something like 30 something percent to close to 50% between 2000 and 2007, while the global average just went up from 20 to 30%. So Asia has become more and more involved with trade. And after the crisis, the great crisis, the Asian financial crisis, 1997, 98, we all have become more open. Maybe so because we have actually been exploiting and gaining so much from trade, because since that day, nearly 15 years ago, Asia has been accumulating huge amount of capital, huge amount of reserves, and the banking system has become so sound. But when you look at the way we are a bit off balance, and again, I have to hark back to some quotes from a former prime minister of China, Prime Minister Wen Jiabao, you know him well. Wen Jiabao was known to be always rather pessimistic about the Chinese situation, about the Chinese economy. In 2007, I was attending some function which is called the Development Forum in Beijing in China. And he came up with a very shocking statement in those days. He said the Chinese economy is unstable, unbalanced, uncoordinated, and therefore unsustainable. That was what Wen Jiabao said in 2007. Unstable because excessive liquidity, too much investment. Unbalanced because there's a lack of balance between rural and urban. Urbanization went on very quickly. There's a lack of balance between east and west in China, north and south. Uncoordinated because they've gone too much into manufacturing, not really backed up by the productivity enhancing services sector, so it was uncoordinated. And unsustainable because China was producing a lot of pollution. And China was very, I would say, uneconomic in the way they used resources in those days. So this was actually Premier Wen Jiabao's ideas in those days. So this is actually the real background of Asia move in the future. Asia cannot become, as in the past, so much reliant on trade as we've seen in the past, because trade, before the Great Recession 2007, 2008, 2009, trade was expanding something like 6, 7, 8% per year. And the last few years, since 2012, trade has been expanding at a very anemic rate, lower than the global output growth rate, which is just, used to be the opposite. Trade used to expand by twice the rate of the global output rate. So now output rate 3%, trade is about 2.7% in the last few years. So we are contracting in terms of being involved with the whole trade. We are seeing the contraction in Europe, recession, double recession in Europe. Last year there was threat to have a recession in Japan. So Asia involvement in trade these days is not really something which the Asian leaders should rely upon. So we all at the moment, and I think all the Asian leaders, are trying to think of a new model. How can we be less reliant on pure trade alone, less reliant on cheap labor, on manufacturing, on the management of our currencies, undervaluation of currencies? So we have to change this mindset. And I would like to end by saying that if you look into the past figures, and I got here, but you know all these figures, the size of the Asian economies, everything, Asia now produces something like 40% of the global output, and we have 60% of the population. So we still have room to grow in terms of productivity. So what Asia has been doing in the past few decades to come this far, to grow, on a basis of 5, 6, 7, 8%, this is something that Li Keqiang has admitted, and in the last National People's Congress, he was saying, look, he used the word formidable, I think. This year, we're going to have formidable problems, much more so than in the past. So if we grow by 7%, it should be okay. Now, this is the kind of attitude that we are seeing around Asia this day. You're seeing Mr. Xi Jinping in China attaching great importance on governance, going through all this corruption, trying to eliminate all kind of corruption practices throughout China. You've never seen this kind of practices before in China. You see the rise of Mr. Modi in India, who comes up with his plan to help privatize Indian economy more, to reduce the license large. They call it license large when the government gives out licenses in everywhere. So Mr. Modi has been very successful, I think, in Gujarat when he was in Gujarat. He's now trying to apply the same model from Gujarat, which is very liberal economy, to the whole of India. I don't know whether he would be successful with that. For this, I just reminded, I have to recommend these two books to you, but you know them probably better than me. The two good books on India, which will show the kind of dilemma that Asia is facing today. There is one good book by Professor Amartya Sen, another Nobel laureate, with his colleague Jean Dretz. This is a book called An Uncertain Glory, India and Its Contradictions. And there's another book which says something like the opposite of what the Sen book was saying. This is my friend's book, Jagdish Pakwadi's book with Arvind Panagaria. This is a book which is called Why Growth Matters, How Economic Growth in India Reduced Poverty and the Lesson for Other Developing Countries. One book, Sen was saying that India cannot grow like this. You look at India 20 years ago, India in social terms was doing far better than, for example, its neighbor Bangladesh. 20-year ons with high growth, India now has lower life expectancy and higher child mortality than Bangladesh. How can this be possible? India has more than 50 billionaires, 500 channels television, but still one-third of population living with no electricity. So again, Sen was saying that you cannot grow and then you just wish all this away. The state has to get involved. Why? While Jagdish was saying just the opposite. He said, well, no, you have to leave it to the market. So this is something that just my time is coming to an end. This is the model that Asia has to change to. On capitalism, how is Asia going to approach the way the world is going to liberalize? And sometime at the moment, there is a counterforce against globalization. A lot more restrictive trade measures are being put on the board in terms of non-tariff barriers. We're seeing all this. You're seeing multilateral negotiations failing from all the time in climate, in finance, in trade. So we're not seeing this kind of the globalization through capitalism working well. In terms of democracy, I think you must have heard what our Prime Minister was saying in terms of interpretation of democracy in Asia. There's different interpretation of democracies. Who's right, who's wrong? And I was always reminded of the saying of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, who always say that we always have our own value. There's an Asian value to democracy, so sometimes you have to allow us to use our democracy. And in terms of governance, this is something that I think we should have the same mindset that whatever we do, Asia would have to work on rules of law. That's why all this integration effort in Asia, all these efforts are so important. Asia has never done so much in terms of integration as in the last 5 or 6 years. We have gone into ASEAN completion of the ASEAN free trade area. We have gone into the ASEAN economic community. The ASEAN economic community is going to take up 6 more countries. China, Japan, Korea, India, New Zealand, Australia, to make it ASEAN plus 6, what we call Regional Economic Partnership Agreement, the RCEP. Here in came United States with the ideas of Trans-Pacific Partnership. China last year in the meeting, APEC meeting in Beijing, came up with the FTAAP, Free Trade Area of Asia and Pacific. So all this actually integration effort in Asia are pointing towards the need for Asia to cushion itself, to trade more among itself, to make use of the global regional supply chain concept to heighten it, so that we can enhance our Asian intra-Asian trade, which is now at the level of 55% of the global trade of Asia. This is one of the highest in the world, lower only against when you measure against the trade, intra-European trade, and also inside NAFTA. But this is one of the highest in the world. So They want to enhance this. They want to jump across the middle income trap by coming away from the cheap labor base, just being able to put things together into one which can control distribution network, R&D. That's why I went to Germany and I saw a lot of people who are now investing with us in the area of education. Education is important, and now several German universities are helping universities in Busan, in China, in Vietnam, in Thailand, in Singapore, to train electrical engineers, for example. So much this last few years. So when you look at the figures of Asia, you tend to see the kind of quantitative figures. Asia, with a few billion people, we have 60% of the global humanities. We are bound to produce at least that much. But that doesn't say anything. When China becomes the largest exporter of the world, for me, it doesn't say anything. You are the largest in terms of population. In a few years now, they'll be the largest economy in the world, so it doesn't say anything because you're the largest. But it means that at the moment, we are going through a transition period that Asian economies will have to look at quality, inclusive development, equality, gender equality, geographical equality, opportunities, equalities. In terms of infrastructure, it has to be in terms that you don't have digital divide, you have to be able to communicate, and you have to be able to transport goods in the most efficient way. That's why China is putting up what now we call, and I would end by doing this, China is putting up what we call a big Asian Marshall Plan. I talked already in the beginning, and I said I would say this at the end. This is the so-called the renewal of the Silk Road. This is a pretext to create funds. 40 billion of fund at the beginning to invest in the Silk Road, which means that would help to try to construct roads, railways, improve towns, cities, custom procedures along the roads from China to Europe, also around the maritime. You know that at the moment you can ride on the train from Chongqing in the western part of China to Antwerp, the port of Antwerp. They carry now goods from the western part of China through this train connection, which would take about 15 days. It saves a week instead of transporting things through the eastern side. So this is one thing which we are seeing, and China has set up another big bank, which is called the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB, which the US is not very comfortable with, so US is not joining. It's not joining. Why US is not joining? US is saying, look, we have the World Bank. Why don't you use the World Bank? The Asians are saying, the Chinese are saying, and Thailand is joining, and there are 27 participants. We're saying, this is huge. This is something that we need more banks, as many as possible, because ADB also has set up the infrastructure fund. So now this bank has been set up just a few days ago. UK has just signed to become the first advanced countries membership of this bank, and the US was a little bit, nervous about it. But anyway, they said, well, there are too many banks like this, and the standard might not be there. But I just would like to relay all this information to you so that you would know that the way that economic trade, macroeconomic policies in all these countries, geopolitical play, why the maritime Silk Route? Maritime Silk Route in the past, in 1,000 years ago, was not much. But this day, it's going to be revived because of all this geopolitical confrontation, all these islands around Southeast Asia. So this is something which the aim of the present leadership of Asia is moving to. And I just like to end by give you a small quote from President John F. Kennedy, which I like very much. And he said something like this. He said, if a free society cannot help the many that are poor, it cannot save the few that are rich. And this is the philosophy that we are operating at the moment in Asia. Thank you very much for your attention.